The Toyota AE86 is undoubtedly one of the most recognisable and famous Japanese cars, and these days they're getting a little bit rare, so it's unusual to come across one at a race meeting, particularly one that has been competing in the South Island Endurance Series for some 10 years. So we're here with Ryan from Heagney Racing to talk a little bit about this particular car. So first of all, Ryan, this isn't a rebadged AE85, which is probably a bit more common. It's the real deal. It's a genuine AE86?
Yeah, it's the real deal. It's the AE86, genuine New Zealand new article, yeah.
So that's probably sacrilege, actually cutting up a car that is now so rare, but this has been a race car for a fair while. So when was it actually built?
Yeah, so originally 1992 was when its first race meeting was recorded in the logbook. Was probably a very cool car for the day to be racing. Obviously since then it's gone through a few rebirths. It started off with the 4H engine and obviously the T50 box, and we bought it with the 4H engine originally, probably 15 years ago now, and we purchased it. Yep.
All right, so the original engine though, it's long gone. You've got a 3S-GE Beams engine in there, plus a turbo system. So what was the sort of idea behind going the Beams engine?
So we were splitting the 4H block at about an hour through the race. So we decided we needed more capacity. So we went to the 2-litre Beams, and we went to that in about 2006. Which back then no one was really doing the Beams swap, you know, no one knew about the cam control. It was quite a new build, no one did turbo pistons for it. Yeah, it was actually a bit of a challenge back then, yeah.
So even today I think the Beams is probably an engine that is not as widely used as perhaps it could be, and one of the earlier engines from Toyota that actually used continuously variable cam control. So that gives you some advantages. Are you still running the cam control?
Yeah, we're still running the factory cam control with the factory camshafts, yeah.
So I'll get into the rest of the block setup and the rest of the combination in a minute, but using the continuously variable cam control, the idea behind that is it gives you the ability to optimize the cam timing as the engine's running. So what's that sort of give you in terms of advantages in the power band?
So it actually gives you a power band that's more like a V8. It's nice and wide. You don't have that spiky turbo power. It's that, you know, 3200, 3400, and it's all in. You've got everything, all the torque you need, which is what you need.
Yeah. So you're all in by about 3200 RPM. Yeah. Where are you revving it to, and where's it making peak power?
It makes peak power around 6, so we're revving it to 6. It can rev right out to 8.5 if you're in qualifying and on high boost, which is sometimes useful, but normally 6,000 seats, yep.
So is that just really in defense of reliability of the engine over an endurance race, as opposed to trying to get every last tenth of a second out of the lap time?
Yeah, and I figure if you're in a higher gear, you're probably going faster. So get in a higher gear and use the torque of the engine, which is what the VVTi does, yeah.
Now, obviously the key to the performance there is the turbocharger. So can you talk to us a little bit about that combination? I know you've said you've tried a variety of different wheels, etc., and it's been developed over a few years now.
Yeah, so Jared from TurboGear helped us develop the turbo package over a long time. It's a twin-scroll BorgWarner style S200 turbo. I can't tell you the wheel sizes, I don't know them, but we're in about the sweet spot for the turbo now, where we put in sort of 2 PSI boost to make about 50 horsepower, which is about where we want to be. Yeah.
In terms of the power level that you are running and the boost level on track, what are we talking there?
It's around that 460 on low and around that 480 on high. You can run it up to about 520 to 550 in qualifying, but it's just not going to last running that high, yeah.
And what sort of fuel are you using to make that power?
So we're just using avgas. We have tried other fuels, but for the fuel burn that we need to be able to last for 3 hours, avgas is our only option. Yeah,
I guess these days E85 is the go-to option, but of course you're using around about 40% more fuel to make the same amount of power, and the consideration there is, as you say, the fuel burn, and you're going to be doing more pit stops, so ultimately the car ends up slower. All right, let's talk about the rest of the engine combination. So you mentioned that getting turbo pistons for the 3S-GE Beams engine can be challenging, so what are you running there?
Originally we ran a handmade piston. A guy that we knew a guy, and he made us some pistons, and we ran them for probably 4 or 5 years, and then by that time we realised that he was no longer able to make them, and we sent a piston to CP with our design, and they obviously made the piston, and that's probably the piston everyone buys now.
So you were really developing that whole market?
Yeah, we were die grinding out the top of the pistons to add valve clearance as we pushed the cam control harder. Yeah, it was a real world test, yeah.
And what about the rest of the engine spec in terms of crankshaft, con rods, etc.?
So it's just a factory cam crankshaft. It's got H-beam rods, and it's got a Darton sleeves in the block. The block's filled with concrete, try and hold it together. Other than that, it's relatively standard, still runs a wet sump, and yeah, that's probably about it for the engine.
Let's just go back to that. Sleeving a cast iron block is not particularly normal. Yeah. That's something we normally see on high output alloy blocks where there isn't really the strength in the sleeves. So why did you deem that necessary? Were you having issues with splitting the bores in stock form?
Yeah, we split two blocks straight down the bore, and we basically put it down to cylinder pressure. So it may not be the horsepower, but it was the time. Obviously, as the race went on and you were an hour and a half, 2 hours in, everything would get so hot and eventually something would give away, and it was the block. So we had a lot of trouble putting the sleeves in. We think we might have got it sorted now.
Now, one of the problems I just want to talk about on that note, we see this time and time again with people who sleeve a block to fix a problem with bore strength, and of course it's going to fix that problem, but quite often that actually brings about its own set of issues with the sleeves actually dropping in use and then head gasket sealing issues. So is that the issue you're talking about?
Yeah, so the first block, you would pull the head off and the head studs would all be high. It was pulling the deck up, and every time the head studs were high, you could tell straight away that the deck of the block was actually deforming. And it was destructive testing where we actually cut the blocks in half to find out the problem. And then now we've worked out the correct liner thickness to run, and we're now not having any issues with the deck moving. We're just having a few issues with the liner height when we first set it. It's quite difficult to get the liner exactly right in the block.
I mean, a lot of the people I talk to who do a lot of sleeve blocks have sort of resorted to the point where they know that the sleeves may actually drop in use, so they kind of assemble the engine, run it on the dyno, and then strip it and then deck it. Once it's moved once, it seems to be right. Okay, now you also talked about wet sump there, which again is unusual. Obviously going to a dry sump system involves a fair amount of expense, but that can be cheap in terms of not rebuilding an engine frequently because of bearing issues. So what have you done with the wet sump system to keep that reliable?
It's completely factory.
So oil surge, just not an issue. Toyota got it right?
We run electronic oil monitoring, and obviously the car's on slicks. We're pulling quite a few G's out there. We run a specific oil level. That's probably the key. And we've only got one track. We have a slight oil surge issue, and that's manageable with the driver.
That's amazing. That's probably one of the few engines I've heard of where it doesn't have oil control issues on slicks, but I think that's also important to mention that if you don't have a problem, then there's no need to fix it. And as I mentioned, dry sumps are expensive, so if you can make it work, all power to you. Let's talk about the rest of the drivetrain. So what's the gearbox you've got behind that?
It's a TTI GTO 6-speed sequential behind it.
6-speed sequential gearbox. Obviously you've got the ability, if you want, to use gear change ignition cart. Yep. Are you doing anything like that?
Yep, it's got closed loop gear control for upshift only. Yep.
And cable throttle still, so you're using a manual blip for the downshift?
Yep, I like blipping the throttle, it's a fun thing to do. Yeah.
Gives you something to do when you're in the braking zone, right?
Yeah, exactly.
All right, and moving to the rear of the car, probably not likely that the stock AE86 rear end was going to support the power there, so what have you done there?
So we've got a Hilux head, and we're running Race Products wheel ends. They're a 950 series, they're quite a big wheel end, so we can get camber and tow, which obviously aids handling, but also means we've got nice strong axles as well. Yeah.
So that's something that typically we don't see a lot of with a live axle, the ability to adjust camber and tow, albeit a live axle doesn't quite need the amount of negative camber that an independent rear does. But so how do you actually go about adjusting that? How do you make adjustments to tow and camber?
You can buy adjustable wedge that goes in and actually moves the whole wheel bearing assembly over, and there's an outer CV, a ball drive unit. It's a package that they guarantee does a second to lap pretty much, and it does, yeah.
Impressive. Now, the other thing we're talking about is the diff center off camera before we started this interview. So you've gone with what is probably a slightly unusual option there. Can you tell us about that?
So it's a Detroit locker, or a Spartan locker, whatever you want to call it. So it's a direct tooth engagement locker, and we've run it for probably 9 years at least. It's the original one, and it works great.
So the argument for not using a Detroit locker is the locking action is very abrupt. It's either completely locked like a spool, or it's completely open. So does this create any drivability issues?
It does. It's a different driving style. So you obviously have the unlock when you turn in, which is great for turning. And then once you put the power on, you know that it's locked. So it's a matter of where you apply the throttle for us anyway.
So as you mentioned there, the turn-in's really the key point there, because if you're running a full spool, then typically that's very hard to get the car to turn into the corner. So with a Detroit locker, it's completely open, so that overcomes that issue.
Yep, and even like single wheel lockups, not an issue. Yeah, everyone has trouble. We just haven't been lucky.
Let's talk a little bit about the electronics package in the car. So what have you got controlling the engine?
It's a Link G4 Fury ECU, and we just run an AIM Solo 2 for our lap times and data.
So are you running an AIM Solo 2 that has the CAN connection to the ECU? So that's your sole data analysis point?
That's the sole for the driver data. We still do pull data off the Link ECU for everything else, boost control and stuff like that. Yeah.
So for an endurance racing car, the reliability of the engine is obviously a consideration, as well as the rest of the drivetrain. So for you, when you're at a test day like today, are you looking at data after a session? What are the key aspects that you're interested in?
We're looking at, well, everything really. You're looking at your air fuel ratios. Are they right? Are they on point? You're looking at your boost control. Is it accurate? Is it exactly where it should be? Are you getting any creep? You're looking at your intake temps. You know, you're looking at your engine temps. Yeah, you're having a really good look over everything, because any little thing you can fix today is a lot easier tomorrow, yeah.
And do you generally find when you go to a new track and you get to the test day and you start doing some running that there will be changes that are needed from track to track based on atmospheric conditions, etc.?
Yeah, the tune's pretty stable in this one. We do sometimes get in other cars we've got to make slight adjustments, but this one here's normally pretty good. It's just the twin wastegate system is extremely temperamental. So you will get, if you're a really cold Invercargill day, yeah, it's hard to control the turbo. And obviously a hot day like today, it's normally a little bit down, yeah.
Are you using closed loop control through the ECU for that?
Yep, yeah, we're using the closed loop control, but it's just so sensitive with the twin wastegates that you've got to keep your eye on it and make sure it's exactly right, yeah.
All right, look, it's been great to get some insight into the car there, Ryan. Definitely one of the ones that I'm interested in seeing how it goes tomorrow. So we wish you all the best.
Cool, thank you very much.
If you like that video, make sure you give it a thumbs up. And if you're not already a subscriber, make sure you're subscribed. We release a new video every week. And if you like free stuff, we've got a great deal for you. Click the link in the description to claim your free spot to our next live lesson.